Hey everybody, my name is Paul Esten Jr., a.k.a. Boy Green. I'm the New York Jets digital reporter for Heavy.com, and welcome to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/BoyGreen25, and oh my, do we have a guest here on the show, and this is a New York Jets legend. For me, personally, my favorite New York Jet of all time, and we welcome him here on the show, and I still can't believe it, I'm pinching myself as I welcome him in. Jerricho Cotchery, Mr. 8-9, New York Jets legend and future Ring of Honor member. Let's bring him in here. Jerricho, what's popping, baby?
Nothing much, man. I appreciate you having me on.
Of course, Jerricho. Like I said, this is an absolute honor to have you here on the show again. You are one of the greats, and I got to be honest, Jerricho, it was amazing to see you. We saw some of the photos from NewYorkJets.com. You were hopping over there at Mandatory Minicamp. How did it feel being back?
Man, it felt great. It felt great being back. Familiar grounds, just nothing but love for the New York Jets, man. And it was awesome to be able to go out there and watch practice and get to meet, you know, some of the great guys over there, and Joe Douglas and Coach Sala, who are leading the organization right now.
And Jerricho, I thought they were going to sign you. You look pretty good, man. I thought you were going to, you know, start running some routes out there. You still got any gas left in the tank?
Hey, no. We got a good group up there already, you know. And so I'm eager to watch those guys get on the field this fall.
By the way, was that your first time back in a while?
Yeah, that was my first time back. It was my first time back, but it was more than I could have ever imagined it would be. You know, it was just a wonderful feeling to be back in the building and walking around and seeing some familiar faces, and just really, like I said, it was great being back home.
Now, I'm sure memories are just rushing through your head as you were kind of walking around the facilities. Who was it? Was it Woody Johnson who gave you the call and said, come on, what are we doing here? Jerricho, come on down. Who made the call?
Yeah, well, you know, it's been a long time coming, quite honestly. Agreed. Like, once I retired from playing, my main priority was to hit the ground rolling in my transition into that next chapter. Mm-hmm. And so that involved, you know, spending time with my family, you know, vacationing, you know, sure. gathering up all of my passions to see what I wanted to do next. And so I wanted to make sure that part of my life, that transition was going to be great. And so didn't spend much time doing anything else. And as you know, just time flies, man.
Time flies.
And as I took that year, you know, also went to seminary and things of that nature. And 2017, I got a call to coach. So when you're coaching, you don't have much time to visit anybody else, you know. And so time has just flown by. And then that was 17, 18, and 19. And then 2020 hit. You know, just a lot has happened in that time period.
No question about it. Was coaching always something you wanted to get into, or was it just simply a call you couldn't refuse and said, well, I guess I'm going to coaching?
Yeah, well, yeah. You know, for forever, I thought I was just going to play. And then once I was done, coach.
Sure.
You know, but, you know, after a long career, you know, and I did a lot to, you know, prepare and take care of my body and doing all of those things, you know, I pretty much had the schedule of a coach as a player.
Oh yeah.
Late hours, you know, and all of those things. And so I just wanted to take that year off and really consider what I wanted to do next. And so I got cold feet in a little bit when it came to the coaching part of it.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to relax, man. And so 2017 came around and I got a call from Coach Rivera, and the guy I played for, awesome guy. Sure. And so, you know, I couldn't refuse that call.
So after a couple of years doing it, and obviously the COVID pandemic rocked all of us, quite frankly, and still continues to do so out there in the world. Is coaching, after doing it for a couple of years, something that you want to pursue? Is it something, hey, check that off the bucket list, that was fun to do, and now you want to pursue some other endeavors in your life?
No, it is very much my passion. You know,
okay.
I've always enjoyed, you know, helping young men mature and grow and just accomplish what they have before, you know, and so I had a blast doing that for the Panthers. And now I'm coaching the receivers now at Limestone University,
right,
in Gaffney, South Carolina.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's amazing to see you continue to share that craft, that passion that obviously Jet fans know you for. And now you're spreading that to players around the country, both in the NFL and the college world. That is absolutely brilliant. Let me ask you, the Jets think they got a pretty good set of triplets up there with Garrett Wilson just coming in there. First wide receiver they drafted in 21 years. It's been a hot second since that's happened. They got Corey Davis, of course, and Elijah Moore. You got a kind of a look-see at them at mandatory minicamp. What do you think of this crew?
I really like the group. I think it's a group that has a lot to offer. And, you know, even in that that conversation, you know, you got Braxton Berrios. And
correct,
so,
right.
It's a really, really good group, a really intelligent group. You know, it's just I'm eager to watch him. I'm eager to watch that group perform in the fall. You know, Corey Davis is someone I thought highly of, you know, when he came out in the 17 draft. Mm-hmm. And so that was my first year on the job with the Panthers. So
yes,
I watched a lot of tape on him, and I thought very mm-hmm. highly of him. And then, you know, you got Elijah Moore. He's a stud. You know, he can do it all. And so you can move him around. You can do a lot of things with him. Just his ability. He's just so explosive, and his route running is there, you know. And so, you know, you got a good group. And then you got to add a first-round pick to the bunch. yeah. You know, just a bona fide, you know, stud in Gary Wilson, and being able to, you know, offer a lot of things, you know, to what those guys, Elijah Moore and Corey Davis, bring to the table, and Braxton Berrios. I went down to his pro day. You know, when I was coaching with the Panthers. And so I really liked him at Miami, and I'm glad he's with the Jets right now.
Oh, me too. And I'm going to throw this up on the screen. I'm curious, what do you think of when you see that picture? Okay, the old flight crew. Look at Jericho, Braylon Edwards, Antonio Holmes. What memories are flooding your mind when you see this photo?
Oh, that picture is in my home.
I bet it is. It should be. Look at that. Yeah. That's a I got to imagine, for Jet fans, I'll speak for myself. I can't speak for everyone. That, to me, was the greatest moment of my Jets fandom that I've ever seen in my life, to turn around after the bloodbath that it was just a handful of weeks prior, 45-3, and you guys go into Foxborough and you open up a can of whoop-a-dookie and you just put it all over the New England Patriots. Is that your greatest memory as a Jets player?
Oh, man, I had a lot of great memories in 7 years with the Jets. And you know, that's a great thing, you know. But that certainly was a fun night, you know, when it comes to the build up to that moment. And so but I have a lot of great memories. I would have to sift through, you know, a ton of memories, you know, to kind of rank that at the top. But
For sure.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you, you know, how was it? Because, you know, the perception of wide receivers in the league is, Divas, Ocho Cinco, this guy, that guy. But in that room in particular, we're talking about that 2010 season. You're talking about Braylon Edwards, first round pick, Santonio Holmes, Super Bowl hero before even coming to the Jets. And of course, some guy named Jerricho Cotchery, baby. You had those three in the room. What was that like? Bring us inside the locker room, having that much star power at the wide receiver position.
Well, it was awesome. You know, it was awesome having guys, you know, that you know, will go out and get the job done, you know, and especially in those big moments. And so you're talking Braylon Edwards, who was over at Cleveland. And, you know, he had his fair share of good games against us when we played him, you know, when he was in Cleveland. And so Santonio Holmes, you know, we know the story with him in the playoffs. And so adding those two guys to the bunch, you know, you knew you were getting a lot of firepower. You know, the opponents were going to have to game plan for them. But they were welcomed into an awesome locker room, you know, at the time. And so it was just going to be an easy transition for them either way it went.
So there's no egos. No, hey guys, I'm wide receiver one. No, I'm wide receiver one. I mean, you could make an argument. Any one of you could have been wide receiver one with all that talent in there. No egos. You guys are like, hey, we're here for a greater cause here. We're all part of the team. We just got to make it happen.
Well, you know, wide receivers want the ball, you know?
Of course.
Wide receivers, that includes me, you know? And so that's a given, you know, that's a given. But at the end of the day, you know, it was a great team atmosphere. And so, you know, everybody was you know, kind of locked arms in that and trying to roll that way. But also one thing in that is, we had a really good run offense.
That helped.
You know, and so,
Yeah.
We either way it go, we were going to have to get in where we fit in, you know. Mm-hmm. So, but we had a lot of fun.
Well, Jericho, I got to be honest. We're gonna roll the footage here. Technology, baby. I'm going to show you two plays that when I heard Jericho Cotchery, and when I always hear Jericho Cotchery, there are two plays that come to mind. I'm going to go with the one that I don't know if a lot of people will say this, but this is one that always comes to me when I hear Jericho Cotchery in this play. So we're going to put this play up on the big board here and play it for you. And I'm going to want you to walk through this. The Cleveland Browns, New York Jets, that's all you have to say. We're going to play the clip here.
Well, yeah, I mean, off of the line, you know, I had a little release, you know, inside, and, you know, the DB kind of yanked on my hand warmer, and mm-hmm. Right at that moment, my groin popped. And so just hopping around at that moment, you know, seeing what's going on early on, it looked like Sanchez was going to get sacked, and he spun out of that and, you know, started scrambling around, and next thing you know, it looks in my direction.
Well, Jericho, I have to say, so they're going to show it on the clip here in just a second. I mean, you're limping around before the play. Like, look at this. You're injured. What's happening here? And then all of a sudden, Sanchez throws it, and you're like, all right, I guess I got to do this. Like, unbelievable. I mean, what a wild guy. When I think of Jericho Cotchery, like this wild diving play, like, So is that what happened that you said, that you pulled your groin after this? Because after the play, after you made the catch, and you collapsed to the ground out of probably sheer pain, for Pete's sake.
Yeah, it popped, man. Like, you can hear the pop and you can feel it. You know, it's clear as day. As soon as he yanked on me, boom, you just felt that pop. And so at that moment, like I said, it looked like Sanchez was getting sacked. So my head went down a little bit. Mm-hmm. He spun out of it, and now my head has to go back up.
How do you power through that, Jerka? I mean, you popped your groin, and all of a sudden you're like, well, I got to make this catch. You just like make a video game-esque whoop. You had the Inspector Gadget go-go arms to go grab that thing.
Wide receivers, you know, wide receivers, I would say to any wide receiver coming up, you know, that ball in the air is your ball. If it's coming your way, it's your ball. And so anytime you, you know, have that opportunity to make a play and you see that ball coming in your direction, man, that's mine. I have to go and get it. And so, you know, a lot of that, you know, a lot of the coming alive part of it is built in that reality. That is our responsibility, is getting open and catching the ball. And so the ball comes your way, man. That's in the job title, you know. And
I guess so.
That's where the fun is, you know, when you get those opportunities.
And Jericho, I got to say that when people talk about, I brought up the game earlier, the picture from the after, but when you think of that 2010-2011 AFC divisional game, people talk about a lot of plays, the David Harris pick, the Santoni Holmes knee catch, the Braylon Edwards ripping through multiple defenders, and there's a lot, and Sean Green, go to sleep, the touchdown, right? There's a lot of them there, but the other play, of course, we have to bring up here on the show is, I have to say, one of the most underrated plays that not enough people talk about. So our job here on this show is to have people talk about it. Let's play this. We clipped it from our podcast earlier. This is a Jericho Cotchery making a play in that 2010-2011 AFC divisional game that not enough people talk about, and really could have been truly the difference in this game. Let's bring this up here. I mean, look at this. Jericho breaking tackles, running all over the place, jumping over defenders. And this set the Jets up, of course, to increase their lead. The Patriots are making kind of a crazy rally there. To potentially come back and make some app. That's a play that, I'm going to be honest, Jericho, I know it's not your job to talk about these plays after the fact, but no one talks about that play. And that's truly the difference maker in you guys ultimately winning that game and going to the second straight AFC championship game.
Yeah, I mean, that was a fun play, you know, and that was a moment, you know, where we needed to recapture the momentum that we had in that game. And on that particular play, I just had to sit over the ball, you know, route. And, just it shows the chemistry at that point in time. Everything blew open. We had a 1x3 set, three receivers on one side and the tight end to the other. And so there was a little communication issue there that they had on defense, and it just blew open. And so instead of just running to the spot and sitting down, I just kind of slowed down and stayed on the move. And Mark felt my body language at that point in time and hit me in stride. And so from there, man, it was just trying to, you know, make a play and you know, just keep going.
What part of the job – do you enjoy that part of the job where not only catching the football, but how about all the yak, the yards after the catch that you were able to make and make things happen? Is that something you prided yourself on as a wide receiver, is making plays once you got the ball in your hands?
I mean, yeah, I love that part of the game. You know, that was a big part of my game, you know, throughout my career. And even in that, you know, my first, you know, position, well, my second position, I should say, was running back, you know. And so played a lot of running back up until the eighth grade. Mm-hmm. You know, and then from there, those you know, running back skills kind of stuck with me, but I always wanted to be a receiver.
Oh, interesting. Well, you can certainly see it when you're running around out there. And I got to tell you, Jericho, this is just a quick detour here. When I Google Jericho Cotchery, you're my favorite player of all time. But when I see you in Carolina Panthers, blah, Pittsburgh Steelers, I mean, you had great success with those teams too. But Jericho, I mean, I speak for all Jet fans here. You should have never left. Not that it was your choice, but I mean, Jericho, is that something that you just kind of look back on? Again, I'm sure every, you know, opportunity in the league is great. Again, you went to the Super Bowl with the Carolina Panthers, and you spent a couple of years with the Pittsburgh Steelers, getting it from a Hall of Fame quarterback and Ben Roethlisberger. But did you ever imagine yourself in a different uniform after all those years with the Jets?
No, I never did. You know, but at the end of the day, you know, who are you? You know, who do the fans see me as?
Jets all day, baby. I mean, come on, people. You know,
there you go. You know, there you go. And so, man, I love the Jets. You know, and at the end of the day, you know, my dream came true through the Jets.
Yeah.
And then it is an organization that developed me. You know, when Mangini came over, you know, he quickly identified me as one of the core guys. Mm-hmm. You know, this is before, you know, I even, you know, started. You know,
yeah.
He saw me as that type of guy, you know, before that, you know, and he developed me, continued to increase my, you know, football intelligence, you know, mm-hmm. and they ended up paying me.
Yeah.
You know,
sure.
And so they did a lot for me. They did a mm-hmm. lot for me, you know, and I, you know, my wife and I, that was our first year of marriage when I got drafted to the Jets. And so,
oh, wow.
You know, we grew so much, you know, as Jets. Mm-hmm. And so when we look back on our time, you know, that's what we remember.
And that's always good to remember. And Jericho, let me ask you about, we've had a lot of these seasons, unfortunately, in Jets history, where you just look at the team and I look around and say, oh, we're going to win the Super Bowl, baby. And that year I'm talking about Brett Favre, 8-3. You guys take out the 10-0 Tennessee Titans. You take out the New England Patriots in overtime. I'm like, oh, my, move over, baby. They were talking on ESPN, all the television shows. Oh, man, Jets going for the number one seed. And unfortunately, ultimately, the 1-5 stretcher, you guys don't make it. Did you guys think in that moment, we're winning the Super Bowl, let's do this thing, we're going on a run and we're going to make it happen? Because that's really the run before the run. That's before, of course, the back-to-back AFC championship games.
Well, we had the core guys in place. Mm-hmm. That's what Mangini did. He put a bunch of selfless guys, smart guys, tough guys, hardworking guys in place, you know, and you know, we were ready. You know, we were ready to make a run. You know, unfortunately, things happen, you know, throughout mm-hmm. the season. You have to have a lot of things fall in place. And so it, you know, we had some things that made it very challenging to continue to push forward, you know. And so, you know, it happens, man. That's the NFL, you know. But the very next year, you know, we were right back in the thick of things and, you know, playing for an AFC championship.
I talk about opposites. I got to imagine Eric Mangini, then Rex Ryan. That had to be kind of weird in back-to-back years, and getting that kind of difference at the head coach position.
Well, it wasn't weird for me. You know, that was – Rex Ryan was my third head coach.
I guess that's true. You know, that's a good point, yeah.
And so you kind of get used to the different personalities. I had a different person, you know, different, you know, had experience under different personalities, mm-hmm. you know, for my entire career. And so, you know, it was just, you know, it was just business as usual. Mm. You know, just another voice coming in, and you're trying to get it done for the Jets more than anything. And and that's what it was about. It wasn't about, you know, one guy. It was about the Jets period. And so that was the approach.
What's the NFL moment that hit you? Because you come in as a rookie, right? A fourth rounder. You come in, you're just handling your own business. And all of a sudden, you just find out, ultimately, well, this is a business. Again, the revolving door at head coach for a little while until you guys go on the mini run. Rex Ryan's there for a long time, obviously. He was there for a significant chunk. What was it, the coaching movement all the time? What hit you that you said, whoa, okay, this is the NFL. This is a business. I just got to kind of come to the office and take care of my own business every day. I can't really control all this extra stuff.
Well, you know, I never really, you know, focused so much on that business aspect of it. You know, just the love for the game kind of overshadowed, you know, all of that extra stuff. You know, you know, things happen. You see guys get cut and guys get, you know, traded and things of that nature, you know, even coaches getting traded, all of that stuff. And so just your love for the game just makes you more focused on the job, the task at hand. And so that was my main focus. You know, I think the only things that really kind of made me say, man, this is the NFL is just schedules.
Oh, yeah. A lot of people talk about that. Yeah.
You know, meeting different guys. You know, at this day and age, you know, you bring in different people to talk to your rookies, mm-hmm. you know. But when I came in, you know, Chad Pennington,
right?
You know, Curtis Martin,
sure,
Kevin Mawai, you know.
Yeah, name drop, baby. I like it. Yeah.
we had those types of guys that were already on the team coming in speaking to the rookies.
Yeah, that's good.
You know, and so. You know, when you kind of have that foundation set for you early on, man, that's awesome.
By the way, what was your relationship with the media? Did you like the media? Everyone talks about the big bad media, New York media, with the players. What was your relationship like with the media?
It was lovely. You know,
oh, lovely. Okay.
There weren't any problems. You know, mm-hmm. that I had. You know,
yeah.
You know, they asked the questions that they wanted to get answers from, mm-hmm. and you know, I tried to do my best to answer those questions. You know. Mm-hmm. But also do so in the respect of, you know, my teammates,
sure,
the organization and myself.
Jerricho, I threw it out there. You know, I'm trying to put, you know, food into your mouth here and say, oh man, the AFC divisional round, that's gotta be the best. But you're like, hey, I got to sift through some plays. Jerricho, what's at the top of the docket for you? You've had so many plays in 7 years. I mean, that sort of thing kind of happens when you're a Jets legend, for Pete's sake. Are there certain plays that you remember when you just think, when I just show a Jets logo and you're like, wow, this moment, this play, this teammate, who stands out to you from your Jets career?
Man, there's just so much. There's so much there. Mm-hmm. You know, my moment, my welcome to the NFL moment.
Yeah,
was the first game of my rookie year,
mm-hmm.
And I'll forever remember that. That'll forever be ingrained in my mind. Where we were playing the Bengals,
mm-hmm.
and you know the national anthem was sang, and the Jets flew over.
Mm. It's got to be so powerful.
Yeah, that was different for me, you know, mm-hmm. and so that was just a special moment. I remember a lot of rookies at that time on the team: Jonathan Vilma.
Oh yeah.
You know, Eric Coleman, you know, just Derek Strait, who's our cornerback then. Just a lot of us as rookies just looked at each other like, man, like this is it, you know?
Yeah. Wow, that's got to be magical. I also got to say, Jerricho, I just went, how many records does Jerricho Cotchery still have? And Jerricho, I'm not sure if you know this, but you have a few. And some of the ones that I saw that pointed out that's like historic, you still have the most playoff receptions of any Jets player in history with 30 playoff receptions. No one else is in that category. And again, we've had a lot of good ones. And another one that stood out to me was 100-yard plus receiving games in the playoffs. You have two tied with some guy named, Wesley Walker. Not too bad of a guy there in Jets history. So, wow, man, obviously to me, you made an indelible mark, obviously, on the Jets franchise. But those are a couple. Is there something that you're most proud of, whether it's a record or the fact that you're held in such a high regard among Jet fans and continue to this day? What kind of stands out to you that you're most proud of from your Jets run?
We won a lot of games as a team.
Oh, yeah, you did.
You
know, a lot of them.
You know, I went through three head coaches, but we still did a lot of winning in that 7 year period.
Yeah.
You know, and so that was the biggest thing, you know, just it's a team sport, you know, and just being able to lock arms with guys for that long. We were in that, we had that culture of, you know, drafting guys or, you know, the undrafted guys, just developing your guys and so we had a lot of opportunities to play with the same guys for a long period of time. And so just being able to accomplish that alongside, you know, a lot of those guys, man, was everything, you know. And so just winning a bunch of games, you know, and I know the Jets fans are hungry,
yeah.
you know, to do that again.
What are the Jets? I have to ask that question. That's the follow-up. Jet fans have been starving. I mean, we've had one winning season in the last 11 years, for Pete's sake. What do we have to do to get back there, Jerricho, to the good old days, to what you, the foundation, quite frankly, that you and so many of the other Jets legends laid down that obviously has been kind of hidden in the ruins, hidden in the sands here? How do they get back to that?
Well, you know, I am, you know, fans of Joe Douglas and Coach Sala. Just playing against, you know, some of Coach Sala's coach teams, coaching against some of those teams, and just being able to watch from afar, you know, about how they are approaching things. You know, these dudes love football.
Yeah.
You know, not what football can give them or anything like that. These dudes love football. And so, you know, when you got guys that love football, you know, they can quickly identify other guys that love football.
Yes.
And so that sets up for, you know, just a great environment, you know, where you got guys that just are selfless and just are ready to play for one another. And so those are the type of guys that they're bringing in. And you can see that. I felt that, you know, watching the practice, you see the energy with the guys, you see the camaraderie. It's just a really good atmosphere right now. And so, you know, I'm looking forward. I'm looking forward to watching them. I know they're building in the right way. You know, you don't want to get in the place where we're talking so good right now, and we know that they're doing the right things right now. We don't want to get impatient and say, all right, it needs to happen right now.
Right. Yeah.
You know, but they're doing it the right way, and so that's what you want to see.
Here's another record, Jerricho, I'm not sure if you're aware of. In 2007, you had your best year ever, and you had a 1,000-yard season. And it took all the way to 2015 for any Jets player to get back to 1,000 yards receiving. They, of course, double-dipped that year, Brandon Marshall and Eric Decker. Mm-hmm. And you guys are the only one since. Jerricho Cotchery, Brandon Marshall, Eric Decker. It's been 14 years, for Pete's sake, since we've had 1,001. You were just there at minicamp. Come on, Jerricho, pull out the crystal ball. What are we? Who's breaking this 1,000-yard drought? Garrett Wilson, maybe? I know you're a Braxton Berrios guy. Corey Davis, Elijah Moore. Who is it? Who's going to break this thing? It's been too damn long, man.
Well, they got a good group. They got a good group. And so if anybody is going to do that, it's going to be somebody from that group. Mm-hmm. But those guys are working hard at it. Like I said, they're team guys, you know.
Yeah.
They're guys that love ball. And you know, that's reflective of the individuals making the decisions at the top. Sure. And so when you got guys like that, the rest of that stuff will come, you know. Mm. And so they're working hard at it. You see them excited for the next guy to make a play, when he makes a play in practice. All of that stuff that you love to see about a team sport is there in that group. And so as long as they keep that mindset, man, the rest of that stuff will fall in place for them.
And Jerricho, as we're getting you out of here, again, you were at mandatory minicamp. The pictures were catching you, chatting it up with Sala and a couple of the Quinnen Williams we saw you with. Who'd you get to talk to? Did you get any good vibes from anyone? You meet the quarterback, Zach Wilson. It showed you talking to a lot of different players during your stop there. Who'd you get to talk to?
Well, I met the receivers. I met a few of the receivers. Mm-hmm. I met a few of the receivers. But other than that, just Quinnen and Quincy.
Yeah.
They're from Birmingham, Alabama.
Okay.
And so same place I'm from. Mm. And they used to come to some of my football camps that I used to hold.
Wow, really? That's so cool.
Yeah. And so that was really fun to catch up with them. Man, I'm really, really proud of those guys. Man, they've done an excellent job, you know, representing, you know, the city well. I was telling Quincy, you know, the people back home, and they're looking at him. You know, he's a role model. They are role models. And so their dreams are that much closer because they see someone from where they're from, you know, make it to that place. And so it's a reality to them in a lot of ways. And so just keep working hard, keep at it.
Wow, that's cool. And it's really weird how that happened because, you know, Quincy, not only for his own sake, right? Quinnen's a number three overall pick. Quincy goes a little bit later. Quincy's in Jacksonville for a little bit. He shakes free. He comes to the Jets, right? They go, oh, there's Quinnen's brother. And then Quincy Williams starts making plays. He's like, I'm not Quinnen's brother. I'm Quincy Williams, baby. He's making plays all over the place. He is such an exciting player. And really, when he's laying the thunder and thumping people left and right, it seems like it's getting everybody else, you know, kind of amped up on the team. And obviously, for the fans too, he's a really fun player. So I see you're rooting for those Alabama guys. I like that. Nice.
Yeah, no question, man. Excited to watch him.
Well, Jericho, I got to say, this was an absolute honor to have you here on the show. And I'm going to be pinching myself when I tweet this out saying, oh, yeah, just talked with, I don't know, future Ring of Honor member. Again, what do we have to do to get you in the Ring of Honor, by the way, Jericho? For Pete's sake, finally, we brought you back in the building. But let's get the statue built. Let's put you up there, Jericho. What's happening there, man?
Oh, no, I'm not trying to make a case for anything like that. You know, I'm just rooting for the Jets, man. I'm ready. I'm just like all Jets fans. We're hungry, you know, to see that excitement rolling, you know, and I'm just eager for the fall.
Well, Jericho, we got to say, on behalf of all Jet fans, we're rooting for it. It's inevitable. You're getting in there. We can't wait for you to have your moment because you deserve, again, one of the greatest Jets of all time. We love you. You're a Jets legend to us, man. You just played with toughness, grit, and then we saw it on the Browns play earlier. You were injured. You're like, oh, I got to make a play, baby. That, as you said, that's in the job description, and you're just making plays all over the place. That's what you always did. Jericho, an absolute honor to have you on the show, man. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Oh, man, I appreciate you having me.
All right, Jericho.